This is Judge Joe Brown, and we're listening to We All Be News. News-free Dixie for the 21st century.
Adrian, Merritt, Justin, Walter, Carolyn, thank you very much for asking me to come and honor a man I liked and admired a great deal. First, I want to acknowledge that we all did, which is when we showed up. I thank the mayor, I thank the congressman, all the judges, the clergy. I want to thank the people who gave the music. All of them. I want to say that, Mr. Ward, I spent a lifetime listening to all the songs you just played. But never in my life did I expect to hear how great there are to battle him in the Republic. And take the A-train, and then we end with, we shall overcome. I just want to say, let's shut this thing down. The Dharma would have loved this. And I was trying to think of what little I could add. I want to say what I think the meaning of his life was to America and to all the young people who are here and who will read about this and who will walk through the doors of the Civil Rights Museum who never knew him or didn't know anybody who knew him. Yes, he was a very smart man. Yes, he was infectious in his adventurous spirit, his imagination. Yes, he was an attractive man, and he had a big heart. But there are lots of all those. He was a good judge, and he was a good politician. We still come from a part of the country where you've got to be a good politician to get elected judge. But the thing that made it special to me, because after all I knew about him before I became president, and I came over here as governor of Arkansas for the dedication of the Civil Rights Museum, the thing I found interesting about him was he was comfortable with different kinds of people. But he lived and died a movement lawyer, a movement politician. And you heard his colleague on the bench said he moved the cases. He was always moving us outside our comfort zone and his. Nobody wants to say it, but it's not embarrassing, it's the Army. along the movement trail, he got booted out of Southern University. An HBCU, no doubt. Because he was in the movement. He winds up at Clark and Worcester, a place I know well, because there were kids paying attention to what was going on in the South who had no direct connection to the movement, who went out and demanded that their school raise money and put those kids that got kicked out of school for being in the movement in their school. So he goes from New York to California and gets himself elected to the Berkeley City Council. And then he got himself unelected. Because he was in the movement. It's hard to imagine, because in most of the last 20 years, the Berkeley City Council has been the most left-wing government in the history of democracy, but there was a time when they could yank you off if you got too far out of their comfort zone. But that was part of who he was. And here's the first thing I want to say to the young people. You need to be moved. In his life, another one opened. Till just a couple of days ago when he got to go through the grandest door of all. And I think it's worth remembering. I think it's worth remembering that a lot of what makes you who you are depends on what you observe when you're young. How it makes you feel and what you do with it. I actually went back and read part of his first book, his autobiographical book, and I read the fascinating oral history he did. It's now in the Smithsonian, which I recommend to all of you. It won't take you long to read. And I learned that we had one thing in common. Both our grandfathers ran stores in black neighborhoods. But mine was in tiny Hope, Arkansas, and the big difference is that the store that he and Walter hung around in had more merchandise. And they had two big plastic containers of Jackson's cookies, the best cookies ever made in the history of life. And my granddad only had one. But there was just one of me, and I figured out every chance I got. If you are in a small business with a different kind of clientele where people come in and buy everything up the road and they bring their kids in, their parents in, and you got your eyes and ears open, you will learn a whole lot about life that will stay with you for the rest of your life. And the thing that I really like about Darner Bailey, and I want to thank all the previous speakers because they were all on the verge of tears trying to talk about it. I've known a lot of people who were movement politicians on the left and on the right, and they get prone to sanctimony. They care a lot about the human race in general, but they're not so keen on people in particular. Darner Bailey was keen on people in particular. And it's more important for somebody who wants to move people out of their comfort zone, because you've got to know how hard that is. And you've got to be able to appreciate people who look different than you, think different than you, live different than you, and do what they can. I like that about him. I think that he would have been very proud of that great-great-granddaughter of Jefferson Davis, who is a Republican and member of the South Carolina legislature, said in 4 minutes why they had to get rid of the Confederate flag and did a better job of being a talk around us. He was a loser politician, and he all got to start from where you are. And he cared about people, and I hope all the young people will too. The third thing I want to say is, he left a monument that will have to be moved. Not physically, but internally. You can't imagine, if you're not of a certain age, what that Civil Rights Museum means to those of us who were young when Martin Luther King was killed in Memphis. I had not met President a year before I went to Mason Temple to be in the pulpit where he gave his last sermon. And I thought his account of how he had to bid to get the Lorraine Motel to save it against the mortgage holder. And it's obvious the guy was trying to hold him up so he could recover the mortgage, because there was the building went bankrupt and it was put into bankruptcy, and so there had to be a bidding process. And the mortgage was $153,000. And he didn't have that much money. Finally, he just kept scraping and scraping, and I think he showed up with about $140 to bid, and the guy kept bidding him up. So in his book, he says, I got up to $144,000, and I didn't have any idea where I was going to get the last $4,000. But I figured somebody would provide, and I looked at the guy and I said, not a penny more. And he got the building. The Lorraine Motel could be a parking lot for all you know today. If it hadn't been for Don Clay. So now, I'll never forget all the times I was there in 91. Then the people at the museum were good enough to put up a memorial to the Little Rock Central High School crisis and the ultimate integration, and a statue of Daisy Bates, who was a great friend of mine. There are two men in this audience here, my former Secretary of Transportation, Rodney Slater, Carol Willis, who was with me about every day I was a governor, and they came over here with me when I came. Then in 1999, I came back for a third time with Jesse Jackson, because we were on a tour of America trying to pass a bill called the New Markets Bill to give people with money more tax incentives to put it to people who didn't have it than those who did. Seemed like a pretty good idea to me. And it worked pretty well. To get people to invest their money in areas of high poverty or high unemployment and give them tax incentives to do so. And then we went out and ate barbecue. Too much. After the business event. And we had to spend the night here, so I said, Jesse, let's go over to the Lorraine Motel. Let's see if they'll let us in. I want to see the museum, I want to see it. And you know, I say that because for people of a certain age, the power of it will never die. But for young people, we will have to listen to the Army Bailey. We'll have to keep reinventing it, refining the message. What do you want to say about what happened to Reverend Pinckney and the people at Emanuel Lee in Charleston? What do you want to say about what I believe is President Obama's greatest speech there? What do you want to say about the power of the families of the victims to forgive that deeply troubled young man? What does it mean for tomorrow? I actually wrote a quote on the last page of the Army's Oral History of the Smithsonian. I want to read it. Institutions including the National Civil Rights Museum. Institutions are only useful to the extent you can use them to make change. This man was moving all his life, and we're a long way from where we used to be. And he had a lot of fun doing it. I mean, look at all those movie roles he had. I wish we had a movie of the founding of the Civil Rights Museum, and he could have closed out his career as the lead actor in the starring role. But think about it. Think about all the trouble we've had in our city streets. Think about the horrible deaths of the young service people in Chattanooga. Think about the people being killed all over the world today because they worship God in different ways or they're from different ethnic groups. There are still people all over the world who believe that you're different from them. You're not equal in the eyes of God. Army Bailey spent his entire life on the simple proposition that we are equal in the eyes of God, and until we all act like it and treat each other that way and have rights under the law, we got to keep moving. I love being around the guy. I remember every conversation. I remember every moment I was there. But the thing that struck me, and especially when I went back and read about his youth, about which I did not know as much, is that, number one, here is the guy with passionate conviction who actually likes people. Now, you may think that's weird, but if you've known as many people as I have, you wouldn't. And that's what I loved about his colleague at the trial bar saying about it. He liked people. He was always learning. And he believed everything should have a moving purpose, including this museum. He left you in America a national treasure. He left a wife and children and brother and family he loved so much, a loving legacy. You have to decide what to do with it. I ask you only to remember that he grounded everything in his simple conviction that we're all equal. Moved to the very end, he moved. May God rest his soul. He's earned it.
Church said amen.